किया है. फर्स्ट इज काउंट इन चाइना. इन द लेटेस्ट स्लाइड्स वी विल सी व्हाट चाइना इज डूइंग बेसिकली टू अनसर्कल इंडिया टू हैव द इन्फ्लुएंस इन द सार्क नेशंस. सो दिस सार्क नाउ इंडिया इज राइजिंग इज इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर काउंटरिंग चाइना टू इंक्रीज देयर ट्रेड एज वी सी दैट वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद द मेक इन इंडिया. सो वेयर वी शुड एक्सपोर्ट दीज प्रोडक्ट्स वी नीड टू हैव न्यू एंड न्यू मार्केट्स. So if we have relation with these countries, it will give opportunity for we people to increase our trade with these countries. Then countering terrorism. As we have seen that a number of terrorists are entering into India from different borders, or they are having safe havens in these countries while they do the crime and then cross the border. But if we have good relation with these countries, we can counter the terrorism also. And most importantly, global power aspiration. As India today is looking forward to being among the 4 or 5 global powers. So until the time they don't have good relations with their own neighbors, it is not feasible for them to aspire at the international level. So with all this focus, currently government and India, they are giving more and more importance to the SAARC nations. In this, currently government has taken new steps, the SAARC has taken new steps to increase the coordination with each other, to have more relations with each other, and some of the initiatives which have been taken in the recent past to increase the relations further is first Delhi Declaration on Education. Delhi Declaration on Education has the focus that all the SAARC countries, they have good standard of education, they have universal education, like education to almost all the people, there will be inclusive education. When I am saying inclusive education, it means that it should be for the women, for the poor sections of the society, and for almost all the sections of the society, so that they have a good universalization. As we have seen that in the recent past, some of the terrorists, they get into terrorism out of poverty, because they don't have any jobs, they don't have any education. So one of the focuses, apart from increasing the human resources, is to counter that thing also. So in this declaration, a number of initiatives have been taken. Like we can see that promote massive online courses and student and faculty exchange program, and in the same process we have started the SAARC University also in Delhi. But it is yet to take off the motive behind that. So we need to work on that thing also, so that the purpose of the university is solved. Another initiative which has been taken is SAARC Market of Electricity Agreement. As we see, the countries like Nepal and Bhutan, they have good energy resources, they have rivers, they have dams. So basically, what the purpose is, on the other side, the country like Pakistan, country like Bangladesh, they are shortage of electricity. The purpose of having this same agreement, which is like a SAARC Market of Electricity Agreement, is to have an energy grid where the surplus from one country, it can be traded with the other country. Now the countries like Nepal and Bhutan, they can gain by selling the electricity. On the other side, the country like Bangladesh, country like Pakistan, they can have the electricity, and that can be used for their industrial development. So with this agreement, it can help out. And what is the opportunity for India in this case? India companies like in India, they can have the investments in Nepal. They can put up their own infrastructure. They can have their dams, which on one side will help in producing electricity, and on the other side, it will also help in checking the floods in India during the monsoon season. Third agreement which have been done is on the Bicol agreement. Why Bicol agreement? If we see that we want a free movement of trade and labor, we want free movement of goods and labor. So Bicol agreement says that we have a complete infrastructure running across all the countries so that we can have free movement of these things. In this context, if we see Northeast have a lesser development as compared to other parts of India. One of the main reasons why Northeast is less development is the accessibility. Because the geography, the topography of the region is like this, it is very difficult to have infrastructure in that area. But once we have good relation with Bangladesh, we have good relation with Nepal, we can build infrastructure in that region so that we have equitable development of the region. So what is the proposal later on? Because we now more focusing on the SAARC countries, what are the future course of action which can be taken? From this current SAFTA, from this now only a free trade area, we want to move towards customs union. When we are moving towards customs union, then we will be having more coordination, and maybe over a period of time we have a arrangement like European Union, where we have a zero taxation with each other, and we have a free trade, free movement of labor, free movement of goods across all the countries. And the one is SAARC Bank. As we have seen that in the previous lecture we discussed, we started with the BRICS Bank, we started with the AIB. The basic function of these banks is to have infrastructure, so that a common bank is formed and we can give loan to different countries so that they can put this money into different infrastructure projects as well as social projects. So maybe over a period of time, India is looking forward, or the SAARC countries are looking forward to have this kind of arrangement so that this money can be used for developing infrastructure. As we are saying that we want to build roads or have free vehicle movement, we want to have SAARC University, how this money will come? The SAARC bank can be an answer for all these things. So India being the major country, India being the largest country in terms of population, in terms of area, in terms of economy, India has more responsibility to make it a success. But how we can do that? As I told, the government has initially taken few steps. Now we want to take these steps further, which includes doing investment. As we see that most of the countries are poor countries, maybe Bangladesh, maybe Nepal, maybe Bhutan. So India may take a unilateral action where they can put up investment in these countries. They can have infrastructure in these countries. Then helping the countries in the field of technology, which can be in the field of medical, which can be, because we have a good satellite system, we can have the satellite system for solving the problems of these countries. So using our technology for the beneficiary of these countries will help India to have greater say or to make SAARC happen. Another link is culture. As we see, the most of the countries have same culture. In the sense, like if we see Nepal and Bhutan, Hinduism, we have Hindu countries. If we see other countries like Bangladesh, Pakistan, Muslims, we have Muslims in our country. If we see Tamils and Sri Lanka, we have that link. So we can use our cultural heritage basically to increase or to boost our relationship with these countries. So all in all, the development of SAARC is very important for India to take it forward, in the sense so that they have own regional aspirations, they can have economic development, they can have strategic development, and they can counter China also. As I am saying again and again, the focus of India with SAARC or some other policies is to counter China. Why China? Because both of us are one of the most growing nations in the world. At the same time, China is also aggressive, and they want to have influence in the air of India. They want to have their sphere of influence in Indian Ocean. They want to have their sphere of influence in the countries which is surrounding India. So from this angle, India also want to first save their own territory, to have their influence in their region. Basically, the purpose of both the countries is what? They want to have good economy. They want to have greater say in the international affairs. That is the real purpose. As I am saying, after 1980, when China started their economic program, they have an initial silent rise. They were not very much meddling into international affairs. But over the period of time, when they started the economic reforms, they get money from that. They started a massive militarization of their economy also. They started interfering in the international affairs. And the right term which is used is assertiveness. They are getting assertive. They are getting assertive in South China Sea. They are getting assertive in Indian Ocean. They are getting assertive in the countries which are neighboring India. So what is the basic reason behind this assertiveness of China? We can see is securing trade. They are moving into South China Sea. They are targeting the territories of other region. They are moving into Indian Ocean. They are getting aggressive in the Indian Ocean. The basic reason is securing the trade with the Europe. These are the sea lanes of communication. If you can see from China, if they want to go to Europe, this is the route basically. If they want to go to Africa, this is the route. So they want their control on that particular route. And that is one of the main reasons, apart from Earth encircling India, to have their control in Indian Ocean and South China Sea. Apart from this is energy and raw material resources. South China Sea has resources, energy resources, oil, gas, as well as Indian resources. Indian Ocean has resources, polymetallic minerals, and these kind of things. Global power aspiration, as I told you, as with the economic rise of China, they want to have greater say in the international affairs. That is one of the main reasons. And US focus on Middle East. Now this point is particularly interesting. Why this? I will take questions after. why US focus on the Middle East is affecting China. Earlier, US has bases and they have interest in the Asia, but after 1990, because of oil diplomacy, because of their interest in the Middle East, India, China has this almost neglected region, and they have the focus in the Middle East. They have focus on the terrorism. So this has given opportunity for the China to have the greater say in the affairs of South Asia or Southeast Asia. So this is one of, this is again a reason why China assertiveness is increasing in the Indian Ocean as well as the Southeast Asia. As I'm saying, South China Sea, they have issues with ASEAN, and they have issue with South Korea, they have issue with Japan over the disputed islands in that region. So with India, what China is doing? With India, they have string of pearls. We'll discuss in detail about these things. We have Karakoram Highway, we have Maritime Silk Road. So these are the steps which have been taken by China to counter India, both politically, both strategically, and within their own interest also. First, talking about string of pearls. It is again a geopolitical theory, which includes developing bases in the countries which are near to India, and then using these bases for their economic purpose, for their trade, as well as some experts say this can be used for the military purpose. So that whenever, if something happens against India, or whenever there is some tension between India and China, they can use these bases for some military purpose also. Now, if we can see, developing ports, providing soft loan, developing strategic relations with these countries, that is a target. Here we can see there are different ports, like there is a Gwadar port in Pakistan, there is Hambantota port in Sri Lanka, and there is Sitwe port, there is Chittagong port in Bangladesh. So what China is doing, they are developing complete infrastructure in these ports. Earlier I was listening a question about AIIB, why that money is required, why that bank is required. So again, the purpose of having that bank is to provide infrastructure to these kind of things. Now, if China wants to go to World Bank, if they want to go to IMF, there are some conditionalities. Why this project money is used? So there are different questions which are raised in China. But if they have their own bank, like AIIB, they can use that money for developing these kinds of infrastructure, which will help China in long term. So as we see that different ports are used for countering China, countering India also. Although China denies this thing that they are targeting India or something like that. Their main motive is only trade. That is the theory of China. Apart from string of pearls, another thing is maritime silk route. Now, what is maritime silk route? There was ancient silk route, which was a land silk route, and from where China is exporting their products, basically silk, to the European oceans and some other countries. So maritime silk route is an extension basically, or it's a different thing in the sense that it is done on the sea. Again, it includes developing infrastructure on different ports, developing relations with different countries, and providing money and infrastructure to these countries to develop their own infrastructure. So what is the target purpose of maritime silk route? We can see that is getting new export markets. If they have access to Africa, if they have access to Middle East, and they have control on those sea lanes of communication, so it will be beneficial for these for China basically to get new export markets. As China is a manufacturing hub, they need more and more markets to develop their own economy. So maritime silk route will help them to get new markets or easy access to markets, you can say. Secure lanes to import raw material, as Africa is coming up as a big opportunity to import raw material. So they can import raw material from Africa, they can produce the goods, and they can ship these products to different parts of the world. So having bases, having control on the sea lanes of communication, that will help China to get to have control on both these two things. Countering the influence of US and Japan. So if they have their own bases, they have done the complete investment in these regions, so definitely they will be having greater say, or they will be having greater influence with these countries. They will be having better relations with these countries. So that will help them over a period of time in counting US as well as Japan. Why Japan? Because Japan is the biggest, one of the biggest Asian countries, or biggest powerful countries of Asia. So that is the reason. And how this, why China is like this? Because as we are saying again and again, one of the main reasons of China is that they have a global aspiration. aspiration of become a global power. So countering US and countering Japan will fulfill their this point that they can become a global power. Diffusing tension with ASEAN nations. In the next slide, we'll discuss what is the issue with the ASEAN nations. So as we are saying, China is getting assertive in the South China Sea. And their interests are clashing with the, some of the countries in the ASEAN, like Philippines, like Vietnam. So if they have this maritime Silk Road, because China is projecting this project, project of maritime Silk Road, that this is also going to help the other countries. Other countries, the countries where they are developing the base. Here you can see the blue line. That is the basically maritime Silk Road. And these point, nodal points which are reflecting, they are reflecting the different ports which can be developed by China or with the help of China by respective countries. And to reduce regional disparity. One part of the China, the northeast part of the China, they are facing some problem in terms of infrastructure. So like India, China has also regional disparity in development. So this is again approach to reduce the regional disparity. So they can have equitable development all around the country. China has also offered India to be part of this. So that the purpose of Chinese is dual basically. One, they want India's support for the project so that they can execute this project in a better way. As well as they don't want to project this as an anti-India project. Because some of the experts are saying, again, this is an extension of string of pearls and they want to have more influence in the area of influence of India. So China's intention to invite India is basically to allay that kind of fear. So this is the maritime Silk Road. Another thing which is China doing is Karakoram Highway. In this red line you are seeing above Pakistan, there is one red line. So this is the Karakoram Highway which China is developing with the help of Pakistan, or in fact they are developing in Pakistan with the complete infrastructure, with the complete investment done by China. What is the purpose of this Karakoram Highway? It is a part of land Silk Road. First, it is linking Gwalior Port to China. Linking Gwalior Port to China is that they have port access in Gwalior, which is very close to Middle East. So if they want to have some energy resources from Middle East, they can easily export to the China. So they don't have to come by sea route. So this is an alternative to the sea route. So access to port, West Asia, Central Asia, Western Asia and Central Asia, they both are markets for importing raw material, for importing energy resources, as well as they are the markets for exporting their own manufactured goods. So apart from sea route, this will help China basically to give access, to alternative access to these areas. Now if we see the Central Asia, the path of Central Asia is through Pakistan and Afghanistan. So if they have Karakoram Highway which is built through China, going through Pakistan, they can easily move into Central Asia. Central Asia is again have energy resources first. They have they are good market for the manufactured goods of China. So both things, that is the reason of Karakoram Highway. But now why it is threat for India? Why India need to concerned about this? The reason is it is very close to Kashmir. So if it is close to Kashmir, China can interfere in the Indian issues. They are helping Pakistan is in terror. Maybe they can help out in these kind of things. So that's a threat for India. As we have said, China has already offered for the maritime Silk Road so that India become partner for China in these things. But India has not taken an official stand whether they want to join this or not. So what the initiatives which have been taken by India to counter China, or you can say an alternative to China. Two initiatives which have been taken is Project Mausam and Sagarmala Project. So what is Project Mausam? As the name indicates, Mausam. So it is based on the ancient trade route basically, where we are using the monsoon winds, the direction of monsoon winds for the trade purpose. So this Project Mausam, it is a mix of, a mix of culture thing, a mix of history, a mix of geography, and the basic purpose of countering China's maritime Silk Road. So India is using its history, culture and geography to compete with China's maritime Silk Road. So what is the purpose? The purpose is all the littoral nations, the nations which are surrounding the Indian Ocean. So to first have good relation with these countries, to have cultural linkages with these countries and to re-establish Indian Ocean world along the littoral of Indian Ocean. So what is this stretch? The stretch is from East Africa to parts of southern Iran to South Asia and then to Sri Lanka to Southeast Asia. If you can closely look this particular area, the Indian Ocean world, this is very much similar to the region of Maritime Silk Route. So they are targeting, they are countering Maritime Silk Route by this project MOSEM.
So the idea is to only have good relations with countries.
Not only good relations, the idea is to have trade link with these countries. So idea, the same thing which China targeting, the markets, the trade links, the good relations, and most importantly, countering influence of China in that region. If you are providing alternative, if you are providing alternative that we can have trade links, we are providing alternative in the sense that we are providing facilities and the services through our ports. So that they have an option choosing between India and China. Now we are using culture also. When we are talking about culture, we are talking about soft power. So soft power will have more influence with these countries. And we are re-engaging these countries on the historical background. We already had relations with these countries. Now we want to rework on that thing. Another thing apart from Project MOSEM is Sagarmala project. Now what is the Sagarmala project? We have ports, major ports, minor ports. Currently we have 13 major ports. This project includes providing world-class infrastructure in these ports. When I am saying the world-class infrastructure, in terms they will be having energy grid, they will be having optical fiber network, electricity grid, and complete world-class infrastructure. So not only providing the infrastructure to these ports, but setting up new ports with the same level. What is the purpose of these ports basically? Port development to port-led development. What is port-led development? When we have a good infrastructure at one port, the catchment area of that port, they have employment. They will be economic and social development of that region. So that will lead to the port-led development. Earning revenue and providing service to foreign ships. So whenever foreign ships are coming to these ports, if we have good infrastructure, that can be used as a earning revenue from these countries or from these ships basically. Facilities and services to nation, to neighbors. As we are saying, why, how we can counter China? By providing facilities and service to the neighbors. If any country, if let's say Bangladesh want to have exports and they don't have this infrastructure, we can provide this facility of exports through our Calcutta port. If some other country have some issue, we can provide these facilities. So this will help us in countering China, at the same part of time developing good relations with these countries. And again, if all these points have second angle is countering Maritime Silk Route of China. So these are the initiatives which have been taken by India to counter China's string of pearls and Maritime Silk Route. Apart from this, India has taken several initiatives to make the relations good with the China. Why we need good relations? Because both China and India, they are the growing superpowers and they know they want each other basically for their development. As sir just said that there's enough space for both the countries to have their presence for their markets like this. So we need each other for each other's development. If we get engaged in daily issues, daily disputes, then it will be detrimental for the growth of both the countries. So how we are developing our relationship? As we have seen, the president of China just visited India. We are the part of Infrastructure Bank. We are the part of BRICS Bank. And apart from that, we are having different flag meetings. We are different having meetings for resolving the border issues. So these are the different platforms where we are trying to develop relations with the China. So in complete thing, one thing which is common for India is, again, I am focusing on India first. So India is focusing what is their interest. Their interest is in countering China, their interest in developing relations with China, their interest is in developing relations with the neighbor countries. So again, the focus of all things is practicality, not the realism basically. So that is the focus of India in improving the relationship with China. Any question regarding China? Anything you want to refocus? Yes?
China is not a member of the SAARC, but still it
you already answered the question that China is the member of observer of SAARC. Actually, these other countries of the SAARC, they want China to counter influence of India. If they have China, then if we can see the structure of the SAARC, basically, we find that India is the most powerful country. So they want China to counter influence of India. We can see the same thing in ASEAN. Why ASEAN? What is the importance of ASEAN in India? India and ASEAN is again the same, to counter the influence of China. So they want China to counter India. So that is the answer. Another important organization is ASEAN, which is important and getting more important for India, because we just recently signed FTA services with ASEAN. But apart from this economic thing, there are another factors why which makes ASEAN important for India. So Association of Southeast Asian Nations, so that is the definition of ASEAN. We can have just look at the countries of ASEAN, Thailand, Myanmar, Cambodia, Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, Laos, Philippines and Brunei. These are the main countries of ASEAN. So what is the purpose of having this ASEAN is mutual cooperation and to settle their disputes, as well as to have economic and political engagement. Political engagement is important because these are the neighbor countries, and to solve their political issues, to solve their border issues amicably. And why economic engagement is again to have good trade, to have good trade relations and to improve their economy. This organization was founded in 1967 with Indonesia, Jakarta as their headquarters. And in 1997, China, Japan and South Korea, they also joined the organization to give more focus or to give more importance for the regional integration. So how it is important for India and what is the engagement of India with the ASEAN? We just have a timeline here. In 1990, when India started its LPG reforms, they also started looking outward. Outward in the sense is engaging in the international issues. So in 1990s, they started their Lucas policy. When I'm saying Lucas policy is, they want to focus on the Lucas in the eastern part of the world for their trade, to get some know-how from that region. So they started their ASEAN engagement. And over the period of time, the engagement, the importance increased. So in 1992, sectoral dialogue partner. 1996, they become the full dialogue partner. In 2003, they signed a treaty of amity and cooperation. In 2009, one of the biggest initiatives which have been taken in 2009 is the FTA in goods only. At that level, we signed just in FTA in goods, that's a free trade agreement in goods, which got effective in 2010. But over a period of time, we have seen this FTA in goods is not very beneficial for India. In the coming slides, we'll see what happened when we signed this FTA. In 2012, so we moved towards FTA in services. The talks have been concluded, and in 2004, all the 10 members except Philippines, all the 9 members except Philippines, they have signed this agreement. They agreed to the FTA in services. Why the Philippines? Because they have their own BPO industry. They are also service provider to different nations, and they are coming up as a big competitor for the Indian BPO and KPO services. So they feel it's a threat to core their own economy, and they are not very much ready to sign this FTA in services. Before moving ahead on the economic front, like in FTA in goods and services, again it becomes very important. What is the importance for ASEAN, importance of ASEAN for India? Why India require help of ASEAN? So if we see strategic interest, again India wants a like China, we are discussing in the previous slide that China wants easy access, unrestricted and free access for their trade markets, for their sea routes. In the same way, India also wants free access or uninterrupted access of the sea routes. So Asian nations are the intersections of major land and sea routes. So that's why India wants good relations with these countries. Maritime boundary dispute with China and a number of Asian countries, near or South China Sea. So as we were discussing, what is the purpose of having China in SAARC? In the same way, why ASEAN countries need India is to counter influence of China. As we have seen in the South China Sea, they will be having disputes with Vietnam, they will be having disputes with some other countries. So to counter this influence of China, ASEAN also need India. And again, why India needs SAARC was the fact that they want to have a, they already have a global aspiration. In the same way, moving from their own area of influence to the other area of influence. So to become a global power, it is very important for India to have good relations almost with all the countries. But that is not practical possible. So this gives a platform where they can have good relation with 10 countries of Southeast Asia. So this is a one of the big platform. So SAARC is a platform to have good and influential relation with the countries neighboring India. When we are moving towards East, this ASEAN is providing a second platform where they will be having a good relationship with the countries in that region. Apart from strategic interest, another thing is the energy. These ASEAN countries, they are good resources of energy. Apart from that, South China Sea, which is, these are Asian countries are the littoral nations of the South China Sea. So we already have a tie-up with Vietnam for oil exploration in the South China Sea. Apart from this, the country like Malaysia, the country like Indonesia, they will be having energy resources, LPG.